So, what is this amazing thing called grace? And why did Paul start so many of his letters with peace and grace of Jesus be with you? And what's this thing called grace all about? See, grace in the original Greek means charis, which basically means favour, blessing or kindness. It appears 124 times in the NIV, and grace is God giving the greatest treasure to the least deserving, which is every one of us. And his grace offers a whole multitude of things. It offers forgiveness, reconciliation, abundant life, eternal treasure, his Holy Spirit, and a place with him in heaven forever. And different people are given different degrees of grace depending on what God has called them to. Ephesians 4:7 says, "But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it." Even the atheist who tries in vain to deny God whilst residing here on his planet is given a common grace, an extra time, if you like, to come to know him, to repent of his sin. See, the fact God doesn't punish people immediately doesn't show that he is powerless, it shows that he's patient. Even for me, there were many years of my life that I wasted where I didn't know God. I hadn't called on him. I didn't know his grace for me in my life. And God often graces us to bring grace to others, be that by praying for people at a party, professing God's love into lives of people struggling, bringing people to church, sharing Christ-centered content links on social media, and much, much more. Ephesians 2:8 explains that it's by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. So it is a gift, it is freely given, if you like. It's not dependent on behaviour, it's a gift, it's freely given. You can't earn it and you can't lose it. And people who don't get the grace of God are often quite religious, and they tend to work this way. They feel that if they sin, they owe God, so they have to pay him back through their good works and going to purgatory and being reincarnated as an annoying fly, self-denial, being negative and suffering, that sort of thing. But if they do good, they feel like God owes them, like they're always keeping score. They're like, God owed me and didn't deliver, when actually God owes us nothing. We don't pay God back. Jesus does. And God doesn't owe us anything, but he gives us everything. He gives us grace. We don't deserve anything other than hell. Anything else we get is a grace. It's God choosing to bless us rather than curse us as our sin deserves. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. And because we know his grace, we get to speak of his grace. Proverbs 22:11 says that one who loves a pure heart and who speaks with grace will have the king for a friend. You know, there's a little clue there, isn't there? We get to have a relationship. We get to have a friendship with the King of Kings. And grace produces perseverance. There was this guy called Barnabas in the early church, and he went to a place called Antioch. And when he arrived, he saw what the grace of God had done. He was glad and encouraged all the people there to remain true to the Lord with all their hearts. See, grace produces perseverance for us as his people. As we know, there is the human race and the heavenly race. The man Adam who brought sin into the world, and the man Jesus who took it out. Race is not necessarily white, brown or black. Our identity is not found in our skin, it's found in our Saviour. That's why we don't need to worry about things like Brexit. Our citizenship is either in the world or in heaven. As Michael Jackson once sung, "Heal the world and make it a better place for you and for me and for the entire human race." And the grace of God can certainly heal any broken person in this world who calls on the name of Jesus. See, if you're not founded on grace, you'll always feel that you have to perform to be accepted, when in reality, you're already accepted. We're on an escalator of grace. Even when we fall, we are still going up. God could have disposed of us for eternity because of our sin already, but instead, he makes a way for us to be reunited with him in a reconciled relationship. He loves us just as we are, but loves us too much to leave us the way that we are. So he gives us grace. His grace will often convict us more than justice ever could. And you can't resist that. You know, you can try and resist him all you want, but you can never stop him from including you. You can never stop him from loving you. His grace is often known as God's riches at Christ's expense. And what that means is, whilst God, being all-knowing, he knows that we sin, knows that we're really good at getting things wrong sometimes. He knew every wrong thing that we'd ever think, say or do, and chose to take the punishment for our actions out on his son instead. There was a young person who was grounded, and they snuck out of the house one night to go to a party, and at this party they got so drunk they couldn't stand. They had double vision and couldn't speak, and they were wearing recycled food from earlier on in the evening and literally worshipping the toilet seat. They'd broken the law of underage drinking, and at the end of the night they were terrified about going home but knew that they had to, so they got a taxi, and as the taxi approached home they realised that they'd lost their wallet at the party, and fear and terror started to settle in. And furthermore, as the taxi pulled up, the young person saw their front door open, and out came their father. And totally petrified and panicking, the young person saw their father approach the driver, and the father paid and tipped the driver and helped the drunken child out of the taxi, putting a loving arm around them and said, "Hey, let's get you some fresh water and some rest." You know, and it's a bit like that when we come to God. We come to God stinking, knowing that we've been disobedient. We come in our foolishness, we come in our folly, we come in our sin. We come totally indebted, and he accepts us just as we are. He forgives the wrong that we have done. He looks upon us with eyes of mercy, knowing that he's paid the price for our wrongdoings by sending his son to die on a cross for us, so that we might be delivered home safe and sound. See, grace doesn't come to an end like a party does. His grace endures forever, and his grace is sufficient for us. If you want to know the grace of God afresh on your life, then I'd encourage you to say this prayer with us right now. Yeah, Lord, I want to ask you, God, for a fresh touch of your grace. Lord, I repent afresh of the sin in my life, my wrong thoughts, actions, motives and deeds. And just ask God, would you allow your grace to be sufficient for me? Would you come and have your way in my heart for your glory? In Jesus' name.